So Ritesh is a cloud architect, he's a published author, he's a speaker and known leader for his contribution towards data center, Azure, blockchain, Ethereum, Solidity, bots, cognitive services, DevOps, business intelligence and automation. He's an author of DevOps with Windows Server 2016 book, co-authored book titled Introducing Windows Server 2016 Technical Preview along with Windows Server Team. He has spoken at multiple conferences, including TechEd and PowerShell Asia Conference, conducts lots of internal training, and a published author for MSDN Magazine. He has more than a decade of experience in building and deploying enterprise solutions for customers. Ritesh will today deep dive into blockchain and machine learning. Please welcome Ritesh with a big round of applause.
So if your friends are still outside, you can call them in. Thank you very much. So I don't have a very long time to speak. It's just 25, 30 minutes for a topic like this. And each topic, blockchain itself or machine learning itself, can take maybe a month to speak. So I'm trying to bring both the topics together in one speech, which is for half an hour. And so please bear with me because it will be going to be high level. But at the same time, try to bring maximum out of it to you. So machine learning and blockchain. Before we start, a small introduction about me, which already Shikant talked about. But just to provide you the information about the way you can get connected with me and do an ongoing discussion. So there's a Twitter and a LinkedIn account. Feel free to get connected. More than happy to connect with you. So these things have already been mentioned, so I'm going to skip them. So the topic for today is blockchain and machine learning. So just give me a shout. How many people have heard about blockchain over here? Maybe you can raise your hand. Okay, there are not many. And what about machine learning? Wow, so that's better. Thank you. Thank you very much. So these are the two things we are going to discuss today. And the main agenda for discussion would be to understand the basics, very basics of what blockchain is, what machine learning is. And second is to how you can adapt, how you can adopt both the technologies to make careers out of it or to take it forward in your careers going forward. So blockchain, before we even getting into blockchain, let's take a step back and try to understand what is blockchain and what kind of problems we used to have that blockchain is going to solve for us. So there are two main paradigms that blockchain helps us with. One, there's a problem in the way our economies work where there's a challenge of trust. When you do transactions, there is no guarantee that those transactions are going to stay as is in future because you are relying on a third party for your transactions. And to eliminate those untrustworthy things, and to ensure that there is a trust in the transaction that you're doing, you need a different way of working. And second way is the way centralization works today. So for example, if you talk about anything, for example, banking, insurance, or any other sector or industry for that matter, there is a concentration of power, and there's a concentration of the way the things work. Everything is centralized in the hands of few. Now that itself could be challenge in two different ways. One, if that particular body fails, the entire thing fails, and then you don't have access to it. Second is that those people have the power to change the way that particular industry works. So if that happens, it will have a direct impact on you. You don't want these challenges to be there going forward in the way of working that you do. And that's why precisely where blockchain comes into picture. So that's a great saying that when in 1995, when internet started, nobody took it as seriously, or maybe they took it seriously, but think about it today, how would you would have worked with internet in 1995 given the emergence and the way it became successful today? So that's the same story we have both with blockchain as well as with artificial intelligence. So blockchain is actually transforming not only careers, but it is transforming the way companies are working, the organizations are working, the startups are working, and even the developers are thinking about it. Because the industry is getting changed with the advent of these technologies. This is highly disruptive technology because it's changing the way you think, changing the way you work, changing the way it actually makes things work in an economy. So it is the next level of innovation. It is the next big thing happening in the industry. And it is taking all the industries by fire. So what is actually blockchain? So blockchain is basically a distributed database. So I mentioned about bringing trust, bringing about that nobody can change the transactions you are doing in an economy. And that happens because you are writing those transactions in a distributed ledger. A ledger, if you understand, is a place where you document things, the transactions. And so it's a database and a ledger where you document all the transactions that you're doing. Now, it could be related to financial transactions. It might not be related to financial transactions. It could be anything for that matter. For example, if I am applying for a job in a company, I could put that in a blockchain. And that's a matter of fact that will stay forever in life. And it's not going to change. So that I have applied for a company, and that company gave me an offer, that offer letter can come to me through a blockchain. So that is the power of blockchain. So don't think of transactions as just transactions of money, or whereas having a currency in matter, but it could be any kind of interaction that you have which typically have a contract in place. It is durable and robust because no more you are putting up the concentration in the hands of few. So the insurance business is not managed by one particular person, or one insurance company does not manage the entire thing. Instead, it gets divided into a lot of people. So if you heard about peer-to-peer network, so that's how blockchain works. So the entire thing gets replicated across the node. So if I do a transaction, it gets written into one node. Eventually that node replicates that information to all the nodes in the system. So even if that node fails or a group of node fails, that transaction still stays, and when the node comes back again, they can still start replicating. So that's how it becomes very durable and robust. It is decentralized because now everybody has information about everything. I cannot claim that there is an information with me which others don't have. And so that makes me less powerful compared to others. It is immutable. When I say it's immutable, means when I do a transaction, it's written on blockchain, you just cannot change that transaction ever. And nobody has that power to change, in fact, from top to bottom. Right? Now, I convert those things into technology. So if you think from a technical point of view, so the earliest I talked about business point of view, the kind of benefits blockchain brings. But now if you want to see from a technology point of view, it is a database. So it is having a storage somewhere. You are storing it into file system. So there is a chain data system which you are getting stored with a definite format into it. And there are a network of large number of nodes connected through P2P network. But how do you store data into those blockchain? So cryptography, hashing, encryption plays a big role in how you store data into blockchain. So everything, so think of it. I have a big document, a document as big as a book I want to store into blockchain. Is it advisable to do that? It might not be advisable because it's a huge data and I might clog the entire network and the systems and the storage. So to ensure that I store just the right piece, or maybe store in a very concentrated manner, there's a concept called hashing. And I have a slide later on which talks about hashing. But the whole idea is that when you do hashing, no matter how big the data is, it will get reduced into few bytes, few fixed bytes. And so no matter whether you're storing just my name or just a complete book written by me, it will always have those same length that getting stored. So that's the power of hashing. And second is, when you interact with blockchain, everything is using asymmetric encryption, so public key, private key. So just to give you an idea, you should have good knowledge about cryptography if you want to play around with blockchain. Moreover, blockchain allows you to create your own contracts. So today, if I am from an education industry, I can create my entire system through which applicants can file in their applications for joining a college, and I can I can give them a contract that this is the contract and they can sign that and they are part of as a student within the contract for next 3 years and things like that. So the, for example, you can extend blockchain by writing your own contracts and the way things work. So literally the applicability is in any industry or domain. So this was what I was talking about. You can see with my name, it generates a hash below. And this hash, the size of it will remain same whether I put my name or complete document for that matter. And even if I change, it's a property of a hashing that even if I change one letter in the entire document or whatever is there, the hash will change completely. So if you see, I just added a space and you see the difference that the hash changed completely. It's a fixed size, no matter what the size is, but it will change the value. And so storing hash in a blockchain makes sense because it is fixed size. I don't need to care whether how big the data is because I will be storing a fixed size data. And I can be sure that if there is a small change, even a small change in the data, my data in blockchain will get changed. So how does the blockchain work? So you saw about hashing. The data gets hashed. So there's a concept of blocks. So blockchain, the word means chain of blocks, right? You have multiple blocks and you're chaining them together, isn't it? Right? So you're chaining blocks together. So what does a block contain? A block contains your transaction. So there can be multiple transactions within a single block, right? So you created a block with multiple 5 transactions, for example. Then you created another block, which contains another 5 transactions. Then you created a third block, which contains next 5 transactions. And when you connect these blocks together, which you can see on the screen, then you are moving towards blockchain, which it says block 51 has 3 transactions, block 52 has another 3 transactions, block 53 has another set of transactions. The all transaction has an ID, which is again a hash of the entire transaction. So you can see that each transaction has a hash. Now, if you see block 52 is referring to block 51. So the hash of block 51 is getting stored in block 52. The hash of block 52 is getting stored in block 53. Imagine, I go and change block 52 one transaction. So when I change the transaction, the first transaction in block 52, what will happen? The hash of my block will change, right? Because the hash of block is derived from all the transactions. Now, by changing the hash of my transaction, block 53 has to change because it is having a reference to my block, right? It has my hash. So 53 has to change because now I have to store a new hash. Now, if 53 change, 54 has to change. If 54 change, 55 has to change, and it has a repercussions through all the chain. Even backwards, because if a back one, 51, I am storing 50 chain hash of 51 in 52. But since my hash has changed, even my reference to 51 has changed. So the entire blockchain changes, right? So nobody, if anybody changes even a small transaction, a one speck of data, the entire blockchain will have to be changed. So nobody will have that power to do that. Because if I do that, there are multiple nodes in the system which will say that you're doing something wrong, please don't do this. And whatever we say is correct as a community, so this nobody has the power to change these transactions. So this is a general way. So the transaction you saw the blocks. Now those blocks go to one node. So somebody has to put that block onto blockchain. Who does that? That's the job of a miner. So a miner comes and says, okay, somebody did a transaction, created a block, let me mine this block. So normally there are all the nodes that you see on the screen are miners. They all compete with each other, saying who will mine this block? And whoever mines this block actually writes into storage. And once it gets put into storage, then it eventually gets replicated to rest of the nodes as well. So everybody has that information about that transaction, right? That's the power of blockchain. Just a simple example that Sam wants to send some dollars to Mark. That transaction reaches the network. The node competes, as I mentioned before, all the nodes compete who will mine that particular transaction and the block. They compete with each other. Finally, one node wins and he writes to the chain and the storage. Then both the accounts are updated in storage account and then the block is getting replicated across all the nodes. And that becomes a fact and a source of truth going forward. right? Okay, so there are some of the major blockchains you can see today. There are multiple concepts with blockchain. There's a concept of cryptocurrency, so you can have your own tokens. You can have things called wallets where you can store those tokens. There are concepts called accounts. So there can be two types of accounts. A human account where you open an account and you buy and sell transactions and you use tokens. At the same time, there are accounts which are reflected as contracts. So when you write your own contract, you create your own account as well. The contract has its own account. And some of the major blockchains are mentioned over here. So Bitcoin, everybody knows, it's quite famous. It's one of the first one that came out. And if you're following the price of Bitcoins, you know, it plays with your emotions a lot because it keeps on going up and down quite volatilely. But the second is Ethereum, which is the most famous in terms of development of blockchain. So if you're looking for some development, writing smart contracts and extending blockchain, then Ethereum is the way to go. And there are others like Hyperledger, Corda, and Symbiont, and things like that. There are a host, many more, but these are some of the major ones. Now, it is disrupting all the industry. So from a career point of view, think about it. All the industries today, construction industry, oil and gas, utilities, banking, financials, insurance, and you name it, it's all the places, because this is about data and immutability and about decentralization. Now, every industry is having this problem today, and they want to solve these challenges by adopting blockchain. And every industry across the globe, across countries, are trying to adopt this, to implement this, so that when it happens, that they can bring that level of trust to their users, they can bring that level of decentralization so that they are more robust and can stay test the test of times in future. So when this happens, it is not a small change. It's a change in the way you work, and it changes careers, because there's an immense demand in the industry, in the economy, about people who knows blockchain, people who can talk about blockchain, who can deal with blockchain, right, and do development on blockchain. So from a technology point of view, this is a great avenue from career perspective. So if you're thinking of making big in future from a technology landscape, at least for next few years, blockchain is going to stay. So if you want to get started on blockchain, typically you have to have some knowledge about technology, not some, but maybe go a bit deeper into some of these technologies. So infrastructure, blockchain is an infrastructure play. You need to understand how you're going to deploy, for example, Ethereum into your network. How is Ethereum going to work? How nodes are going to talk to each other? How is the replication going to happen? How are mining going to happen about transactions? So infrastructure plays a big role. And so you have to understand technology as from an infrastructure point of view, as well as from a development point of view. All these blockchain are typically open source in nature. So you should have at least a GitHub account where a lot of people actually put their open source thing and try to go and read those existing open source code over there and understand and make sense out of it. Few languages you need to be aware of, not all. At least you should know one or two of them to make sure that you can work on that particular way. So JavaScript, Node.js, Python, and a host of other web technologies. There are advanced technologies you can use like C++ as well to make blockchain work for you. And then cryptology is extremely important. There's no way out if you're dealing with blockchain, because everything is encrypted, everything is hashed before they're stored. And to make sense out of it, you need to understand what you're doing using cryptography. And last but not the least, at least you should know one cloud technology for sure, because you would not be hosting blockchain at your home. You would be hosting the solutions for these companies who are investing on blockchain in some cloud or the other. And so how to work with networks and things like that on the cloud, virtual machines and platform as a service, infrastructure as a service, you should be knowing about all of them as well. So moving gears, that was about blockchain. Now let's move towards machine learning. So machine learning is, again, a disruptive force within the industry. It's not only a small technology piece. It is the way industries are working today. And why is it becoming so prominent? So the primary reason behind is that there are two reasons for machine learning to be so applicable today. It is not a new technology. Artificial intelligence, which is a small part of machine learning, was always there. But it is becoming famous and so widespread these days because of the availability of data. If you see the way in the 2000s, the entire decade, last decade, the way the data explosion has happened because of the advent of social media, because of the advent of handheld devices, apps, and cloud, there's a huge concentration of data at multiple places. So, and to make meaningful insights, to get meaningful insights out of this data, it is important that we do some analysis on them. But the amount of data is so big, it's terabytes and petabytes, that all the traditional methods of doing extract, transform, load, and some kind of a business intelligence is not working anymore. So you need another mechanism to actually work on this data to get insights out of it. And the way to do it is via through machine learning. So, and where do you, so machine learning is the way to actually derive data insights out of it. And so a lot of people have this thing, notion that machine learning is taking away our jobs, artificial intelligence is taking away our jobs. It's not like that, because if machine learning and artificial intelligence is going to take one job, it is going to create five different kind of jobs as well, because this is about augmenting your experiences. It's about augmenting your perceptions. Think about it. Connected cars is the next level of implementation of machine learning and artificial intelligence. When connected car comes, you might think there's no need for a driver, right? So it's taking away some job. But it's not about that. You need then a host of people sitting behind that connected car to manage that car, to do operations on that car, and things like that. So there's a shift in the way things work, the shift in the process, shift in the kind of jobs you do. So if it takes one job, it's open five different jobs. So you need to be aware of how you can adapt the newer technologies or the technologies that's happening current and be relevant to it so that you can shift from wherever the job was to a new job. So if you stay current and if you start adapting these technologies, start learning them proactively, I don't think there is anything that is taking away our jobs. So I just talked about big data, that with the advent of big data, there's a lot of volume coming into it. And not only volume, but there's a variety and velocity as well. So data which was coming maybe slowly within a day or two, now started coming pretty fast. So I have data updates pretty every second, and millions of data are getting updated. Newer data and old data getting updated every second. And so the volume is high, the velocity is high, and there's a variety of data. I get data from Twitter, I get data from Facebook, from LinkedIn, and a host of other sources. So I need to collaborate this data and try to make sense out of it. Some of the important machine learning algorithms that you have are related, are mentioned here, and need not say because you might have already been dealing with them. But in case you are not, then they are actually making things happen for you. So things like regression, clustering, classification, neural networks are some of the important aspects which are helping making machine learning work. Who are the major players in machine learning world? So some of the big names like SAS, Facebook, Microsoft, Google, Amazon, IBM, they are investing heavily on machine learning. So some of the some of these companies, their motto is changing towards machine learning because they now understand that they have the data with them, they can get the insights. How can they make other people's life better using this technology? It's about bringing better things, better experiences to their users. Now imagine if you have a company, there's an industry, say for example, that talks about insurance. Now in insurance, if one company starts adopting machine learning and can bring better experiences to its users, do you think the users who are using the other company insurances will stay with them? They will not. They will try to move because they understand that now the other company is providing them better facilities, better features, better experiences, then why should they stick around? So eventually, the next insurance company also start adopting artificial intelligence and machine learning. And the third will follow. Eventually, you will see every company is trying to gather data and trying to use that data to get insights and serve better to the customers. At the end of the day, it's all about customers. And that's the whole premise of machine learning. So when this chain starts following, every company needs data scientists, every company needs architects, every who can crunch data and make bring insights out of it. So when this happens, you can imagine the kind of career possibilities you have and opportunities you have going forward for machine learning. Again, it's disrupting almost all the industries, so no need to mention this again. This is a fact. And if you want to get started on machine learning, again, you need to know infra, you don't need to technology. Most of it is open source. For example, the base languages like R, Python, they all are open source, and all the libraries that they create are open source. You can use them. And you need large power to run machine learning algorithms, large hardware power, large machine compute stuff. And you get that, you cannot buy that and put that on your home. You can typically, you should use is a cloud technology to deploy these algorithms, run the models, and get insights out of it. So with that, I'll close this, but at the same time, if you have any questions, feel free to ask. More than happy to answer them right now. I have posted some of my details through which you can stay connected, and I'm ready to take questions. So over to you. So there's one question here.
I'm Yogesh. My question is regarding related to bitcoins. So why do you think majority of the countries are banning bitcoins?
So it's not about banning bitcoins. So it's a new currency. It's a new cryptocurrency. So which is breaking the notions about old currency. So people don't understand the notion or the impact of it. So the first initial impact or reaction to it is to stop it. It is an alternate currency, and these companies or government want to still have control over their own currency. You know, when you go into bitcoins, you get decentralized. You don't, one person don't control the entire thing. So they want to still maybe manage or control the way their currency works. And so that is why the initial hiccups or the initial thought process of stopping it or banning it for a while. But I don't see in future that will stay the same way, because this is the next way of doing business, and you need to move. And it's not about money getting converted into this currency, it's about control. So it's not about anything else. So eventually it will happen. So maybe they're doing it now, but sooner or later they have to move towards it. Does that answer your question?
Yep, thanks.
So one person over here.
Yeah, this is Sridhar. I have a big doubt in machine learning. So can I assume like machine learning is a system developed to handle the learnings from the data? So is it possible to develop the machines that actually controls or develop the software systems right from the architecting to implementations that can replace the humans?
Could you repeat that?
Machine learning system can, is it possible to develop a machine learning system that actually develops software systems right from the architecting to the implementations?
It is quite possible, no denying. So the question is it possible through machine learning to actually build systems?
Yes, exactly.
From end to end, from beginning, from planning till the deployment, and maybe do operations for a software system. It is quite possible. It is quite possible. Nobody thought about that we will have connected cars, that cars could be driven without drivers. Nobody thought that that is possible. So it is quite possible. But we need to just think about, are we in that state of maturity in machine learning where we can do this? Right? It's a maturity level. So in machine learning journey and artificial intelligence journey, we are still at a nascent stage. We are beginning that journey. And maybe the thing that you're asking, maybe will come over a period of time in terms of maturity. I would say it's extremely difficult today, but eventually, yes, it is possible.
If at all, if we achieve that state, I mean, how about the employment, the people working on developing software systems, right? Many people are working in lakhs.
Excuse me, I'm sorry to be interrupting. We'll avoid chain questions. We'll give other audience also a chance to interact. Yeah?
Yeah, okay.
Maybe you can take it offline.
Yeah, we can take it offline.
Sure, definitely. Thank you.
Yeah. I think over there, you have a question there.
Sir, this is Rishabh. Actually, my question is regarding blockchain. It's a little technical. Why the block size limit and why not the block size?
Why is the blockchain?
Why is the block size limit?
Why there is a block size limit?
Yeah.
So there is a mechanism of mining, which I mentioned, right? You need to mine blocks. And a block contains multiple transactions, right? It's not one transaction. It's not a relationship of one transaction equal to one block. There are multiple transactions. So typically, you would wait for a while. So for example, you wait for 10 minutes in Ethereum to mine a block. Every 10 minutes, there's a new block that comes up. So you would like to package a set of transactions for the last 10 minutes into a block and then move to next block. So they would like to limit it because that will help them better manage the entire node. So imagine one block having 10 KB of data, for example, and another block having 1 GB of data, right? So now if I have to traverse the entire transactions in 1 GB of data, how long it's going to take compared to having 10 KB? So if I can distribute that 1 GB into 100 blocks, I can easily identify the transaction in which block and go to that block instead of traversing one big block with all the transactions. So it's more an idea about getting into a transaction faster, better, cheaper compared to being into one block. So think of a monolithic application versus microservices.
Ritesh, I have a question here on the stage. Here, Srikant. Ritesh, onto your right.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I have a question in blockchain. One thing interesting that came up very recently is the power consumption by the miners. Supposedly, it's very, very high. And when I say very high, the consuming power at the rate of few, you know, households, the entire country is running, you know, households. So what's wrong with this and what is it like in the future?
So
They're not efficient machines, basically.
Absolutely. Great question. Thanks for asking this. So the way it works, there's a concept in blockchain called proof of work. And when a miner has... So the way it works is when there is a transaction in a pool, set of transactions, and you have to create a block out of it and put it into blockchain, all the miners have to fight for it. Who will put that block into storage first? And why do they fight? They fight because there is a reward for it. Whoever mines it first, they get some money in terms of token. So everybody fights, right? So everybody has their own hardware capacity. And eventually, whoever wins writes it, and then it gets replicated to all the nodes. Now, the challenge with this is that the way the mining happens, when they fight, all the node fights, blockchain gives them a problem to solve. How do blockchain decides who will win among all the miners? So blockchain gives them a problem to solve, and that problem is complex. And it's a complex problem which needs immense amount of compute power. Immense amount of compute power. It's like a recursion that goes on for a while, right? And so every miner, if you have 100 miners, they're all running that recursion algorithm. Who will solve first, right? So you can imagine for solving one block, there are so many people involved, and eventually one wins. And rest all the compute power gets wasted, right? 99 people compute power get wasted, and only one wins. So that is a big challenge in terms of if you see the risk-reward ratio, or the reward that you get of one block versus the kind of compute power you're using to generate that block. So that is what is causing a lot of trouble in terms of electricity cost and also the carbon index. It generates a lot of carbon footprint, which is not ideal situation for the entire economy, but as a whole, world as a whole. And so there's a different way of working that's emerging called proof of stake. So which will not be less compute, which will require less compute, but it will be a different way of working altogether. It's not yet there. It's in the making right now in blockchain, which will come maybe next year sometime. So that's the short answer.
That helps, Ritesh. Fortunately for me, that was the last question that we could ask, so I took that opportunity. Thank you so much, Ritesh, for sharing your learnings about blockchain with us. I think we have a small memento over here, so one of our volunteers can bring it over.
Thank you very much. So thank you, everyone, for being patient with me and hearing me. It was amazing being you as an audience, and that was my time, and thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot.
A volunteer will help you with taking off the mic.